We are witnessing the global governance roll out right now, here in front of us. We are also witnessing the end of an era, the end of a paradigm, and the transition into a new digital system of control, the new digital financial system of control, which will be the cherry on top of the international surveillance state, which everyone is on board with at this point. All the major players, the United Nations is leading the way, the central banks, the governments, they're all on board. The mega corporations are playing major roles in this. This system is going to be basically run on 5G, AI, and the blockchain. And it's here right now. This is the implementation phase. Now, they're going to tell you that it's not happening, or if they admit that it is happening, they're going to tell you it's for your own good. But they'll never give you a choice. And if you do choose to speak out or question, if you dare to question, you'll be considered the enemy. Now, I personally see that this crisis has been used to accelerate this global governance agenda right now we're seeing take place. And they have been working on this for decades at this point. And a common theme that I've observed is not only do these organizations want to push their vaccines on as many people as possible, they want to silence those who may question it, despite the admitted health concerns. So to answer your question from the beginning of this video, does Bill Gates want to implant microchips in all of us? No, I'm afraid it's much worse than that.
Elmhurst Hospital, right? I've been watching that for the last week on television. Body bags all over in hallways. I've been watching them bring in trailer trucks, freezer trucks. They're freezer trucks because they can't handle the bodies. There's so many of them. This is Elmhurst Hospital. Unbelievable people. You look inside and you see the black body bags. You say, what's in there? It's Elmhurst Hospital. Must be supplies. It's not supplies, it's people. I've never seen anything like it.
I don't see, I've been here for an hour. Not one person has walked up to the tents. Not one. Okay? So, and look at all the ambulances down the block. You see any ambulances?
Somebody else taking videos.
Look at, more people are taking videos. Because no one's believing the fake fucking media. You see all the ambulances that are on the block down there?
Everybody's
They're all parked. Videos. They've been there for an hour. You mean to tell me no one's calling people? Give me a fucking break. Come down for yourselves to see, people. Yes, it is Elmhurst Hospital. Here you go. You see the sign that says Elmhurst Paul? I ain't fucking lying. Where are all the people? Where are they? Where are they? I'm bullshitting?
Once again this morning, the city's hospitals will be on the front lines in this war against the coronavirus. In Elmhurst, Queens, that hospital there, lines of people lining up already this morning for about the last 45 minutes. Confirmed cases, people waiting to get tested, supplies are in demand there. And our CBS News' Rena Roy is live outside Elmhurst Hospital in Queens with more on the situation there. Rena?
Chris, you said it. Elmhurst Hospital is really at the center of this crisis here in the city and in the country, with doctors desperately trying to keep up with the growing number of patients as supplies dwindle. You can see barricades behind us set up here outside of the hospital to keep order here, because so many have been lining up every day to get tested. As you said, some of them showing up about 45 minutes ago, as early as 5:30 this morning. Most of them wearing masks here in the borough that accounts for nearly a third of all COVID-19 cases in the city, and the peak of it all still on the horizon. We are live in Elmhurst, Queens this morning. Rena Roy, CBS 2 News.
Rena Fett.
Hello, folks. I'm standing outside of the Elmhurst Hospital Center in Queens, New York, and according to the media, this is the epicenter of the apocalypse, but it sure looks like a ghost town to me. Where's the ambulances? Where's the rushing patients? By the way, the date is March 29th. They just had all the news stories about how they have no ventilators. They're rushing people into the hospital. But you could see it's all a facade. I'm not saying some people might not be sick, but this is way overblown. And you could see with your own eyes, this is real investigative journalism, not the bullshit you see on TV. Elmhurst Hospital, the center of the coronavirus outbreak, and it looks like a ghost town. Where's the long lines? We saw, if you look on the YouTube, the CBS News, long lines of people trying to get tested. I don't see that. Now here's those tents they had set up. This is what you saw on the news. Where's the line to the tent? Nobody's here on the tent. You know, for all the people who say, oh, I know somebody who got it. Yeah, maybe some old people. But this is planned out for an agenda. Research of N201.
All the patients in this room, all the feet that you see, they all have COVID. And this is only one of the several rooms.
The concern is all these ventilators that we're told are coming but haven't really started to materialize. Are they really coming? Will we really get them? I have never seen the increase in volume as fast as it has.
Hey folks, I'm back outside Elmhurst Hospital. Some trolls in my last video said I didn't go inside, so I'm gonna go inside right now and see what's going on in there. Somebody said there would be hordes of people inside, that's why I didn't go in. Let's see. There's the doctor with his mask on and everything. And look at that. Nobody. Completely empty. This is police. No EMS. Nothing. Nothing. Absolutely. Ghosts. That's all they got. You're afraid of ghosts.
Hello?
What? Oh, no problem.
All the patients in this room, all the feet that you see, they all have COVID.
The frustrating thing about all of this is it really just feels like it's too little too late. Like we knew it was coming.
For the health and the safety of all Americans, I'm here to discuss our strategy to prevent and protect the American people from a possible outbreak. I appreciate Dr. Rich Carmona, U.S. Surgeon General, Dr. Tony Fauci, Director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. Scientists and doctors cannot tell us where or when the next pandemic will strike or how severe it'll be, but most agree, at some point we are likely to face another pandemic.
Given, as you heard from the introduction, that I have been around for a while and have had the opportunity and the privilege and the pleasure of serving in five administrations, I thought I would bring that perspective to the topic today, is the issue of pandemic preparedness. And if there's one message that I want to leave with you today based on my experience, and you'll see that in a moment, is that there is no question that there will be a challenge to the coming administration in the arena of infectious diseases, both chronic infectious diseases in the sense of already ongoing disease, and we have certainly a large burden of that, but also there will be a surprise outbreak. There will be a surprise outbreak. There will be a surprise outbreak.
Today is kind of getting worse and worse. We had to get a refrigerated truck to store the bodies of patients who are dying.
Good evening, YouTube. This is Our Future and the Powers with the People. Just want to let you know I am a respiratory therapist, been doing this for 21 years. Show you our equipment room here. So we want to talk about COVID-19 for a few minutes. And first thing I want to say is does it look like there's a ventilator shortage? There's not. Okay, as a matter of fact, we're running less ventilators right now than we would normally run. and that's because people are just staying home. They're not having elective surgeries. Any patient that came in with a respiratory problem was labeled COVID. Now that doesn't matter if it's you got stage 4 lung cancer and pancreatitis and heart disease and liver failure and everything else, you're still, because you come in with breathing problems, you're labeled a COVID patient. Now we have one lady that could do the testing at first, that would go, those tests went to the CDC. Only one person was qualified to test that for the whole place.
We are right now scrambling to try to get a few additional ventilators or even CPAP machines. If we could get CPAP machines, we could free up ventilators for patients who need them.
Five ventilators. Oh my God. Reporting on CNN had its first about the coronavirus.
Pass away from the coronavirus. Everything we are doing right now is to help.
Now check this shit out. Now look, this is Lawrence Fishburne in the movie Contagion. Listen to what Blood say.
But right now, our best defense has been social distancing. No handshaking, staying home when you're sick, washing your hands frequently.
And look who Blood talking to.
To date.
Ain't that from CNN? Or am I tripping?
We're still working on confirming that number.
The CDC, this is Blood from CNN. In the movie Contagion. Come on now. I mean, I ain't no conspiracy theory motherfucker, but this is a hell of a coincidence. And he telling us to do what we gotta do right now in real life in the movie.
Is that in order to become sick, you have to first come in contact with a sick person or something that they touched. In order to get scared, all you have to do is come in contact with a rumor or the television.
For generations, the public has been controlled through fear. The progression of perceived enemies has evolved over time. We were once told that our enemies were nation states and we had to duck and cover because the enemy could strike with great devastation at a moment's notice. Now, while this outside threat used to instill fear and bolster the military-industrial complex was very effective, this enemy could only last so long and was merely a stepping stone. The fear of an outside threat later evolved to terrorists who had no borders. This justified military expansionism globally. While these military campaigns were often celebrated with the removal of terrorist leaders, the wars continued as the threat of terror only escalated, and the terrorist leaders were quickly replaced by new villains. We were told they hate us because we're free. And gradually, we became less free as the government erected a police state and a surveillance state to protect us from the very terror threat they created.
Within weeks of 9/11, the Patriot Act was passed in the U.S. with no congressional debate. It allowed unprecedented surveillance with minimal oversight over American citizens. The alternative, the government suggested, was responsibility for another terrorist attack.
Terror. Terrorist. Terrorism. Terror. 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 Terrorist. 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 Terror organization. Terrorist attacks. Terror. Terrorism. Terrorist network. Terrorist attacks. Terrorist group. Terrorists. Terrorists. Terror. Terror. Terrorists. 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 Instruments of terror. A terror network. Terror cells. Terrorists. Terrorizing. Terror and murder. Terrorism. Terrorists. Terrorist. Tool of terror and terror and torture.
Now we are told the enemy is invisible yet everywhere. We are told our way of life will never be the same, much like we heard in the aftermath of 9/11. And boy, were they right. The public has been conditioned to live in a state of fear. We have been conditioned to rely on the government as our only solution for safety and security. A solution we've been warned of for hundreds of years. Those who would give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety. It's been said that you cannot invade mainland United States, there would be a rifle behind every blade of grass. So how do you take over a country without firing a shot? Step one, declare an emergency. Step two, roll out weaponized propaganda. Step three, enforce a nationwide lockdown. Step four, make the public so desperate they will beg for a state-sponsored solution. Step five, COVID-1984. All to justify freedom as a casualty of war. So what's the next shoe to drop? Where do we go from here? Now, I've been saying for a few months now that we are due for a false flag, and the response has been that either people agree or people are accusing me of being a fearmonger, that I profit from this crisis. I profit financially from this in no way, shape, or form at all whatsoever. Or people say that we're already in a false flag right now. We're experiencing a false flag right now. Now, while this may be true, we must recognize that the stage is set and the need for another event may be presenting itself as more and more people grow tired of the lockdowns, as more and more people begin to resist. Now, I'm just saying it may be time for the people to be reminded just how much they need the government to protect them in this global crisis, right? The people may need to be reminded how much they need to obey, how they need to stay in line, stay in lockdown, get back inside. Now, the mainstream media has quietly been injecting this train of thought into the discussion by saying that terrorists and or neo-Nazis could use this crisis as an opportunity to carry out an attack. Now, I'm not saying that this is going to happen 100%, but based on history, it is a real possibility, and 9/11 is the perfect example. While the rubble of the Twin Towers was still smoldering, they were actively trying to rush the Patriot Act through. And they were met with resistance. Well, how did they respond to that resistance? With an anthrax attack, a bio-warfare attack. And they didn't have to kill thousands of people. Fear alone was enough to sell it. So here we are now. People are beginning to resist. The media has injected the idea that terrorists could launch a bio-attack during this crisis. And now Bill Gates has come out and said the exact same thing. He said right now, we are in phase one, and phase two is a terrorist bio attack.
Well, Bill, since you tried to warn us about this pandemic, and we didn't listen, what's the next thing you're warning us about that's going to happen 5 years from now that we're not listening to at the present?
Well, I didn't want to be right. What I wanted to do is...
I understand. I'm not saying you won. Everybody loses. Nobody wins with us. And I'm not saying that this is not an end zone dance. I'm just saying, what else are we not listening to that we need to take action on now?
Well, the idea of a bioterrorist attack is kind of the nightmare scenario because they're a pathogen with a high death rate would be picked. Now, the good news is, I'm not trying to depress you. It's tough enough.
Too late.
Right now,
Too late.
Most of the work we're going to do to be ready for pandemic two, I call this pandemic one. Most of the work we'll do to be ready for that are also the things we need to do to minimize the threat of bioterrorism.
I've never been one to tell people what to think, and I'm not about to start right now, but I would not be surprised if alarm bells are going off in your head right now. And one day, I won't be surprised if I have to refer back to this report and others that I've done recently where these concerns were raised. Now, why is this important? For the same reason that it's important to note that Bill Gates, the Johns Hopkins Center, and the United Nations, both of which Gates funds extensively, ran a pandemic exercise on the exact same day that the World Military Games were holding their opening ceremonies in Wuhan, China, ground zero, simulating a global coronavirus pandemic. This is important for the same reason that it's important to point out that Bill Gates also almost prophetically warned of this exact same scenario taking place of a global health pandemic during a TED talk in 2015. This is important for the same reason that it's important to point out that Dr. Tony Fauci, who sits on the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation's Special Leadership Council for their Decades of Vaccination initiative, stated that the Trump administration would be hit with a surprise outbreak back in 2017. Now, if you want, you can say that all of these events were just several different coincidences, which just so happen to involve the same groups of people over and over and over in the same exact scenarios which we are currently living out right now. Or you can say that the writing has been on the wall for some time. So what is the end game here? Well, in my opinion, it's global governance delivered through technocracy, which is a scientific dictatorship run by an unelected elite, which are ready to roll out a new digital system of control, which will be run on 5G, artificial intelligence, biometrics, and the blockchain. Your entire existence will be tracked, traced, monitored, surveilled, regulated, and taxed into submission. So how do we stop it? Well, that is the million-dollar question, but as David Icke pointed out right here on this very channel and on several others, if we do nothing, they win. Okay, so we must resist. Now, if you are presented with a situation that you are not okay with or comfortable with, resist it. Plain and simple, resist it. Be as independent from the system as possible. They've been trying to foster dependence upon this system for generations, trying to make it the easy road out. And once you're dependent upon this system, it owns you. Now, they are already talking about coming to people's homes and taking family members away. Are you okay with this? This coronavirus crisis not only falls in line directly with the United Nations 2030 agenda, it has accelerated it. Now, we are witnessing a prepackaged global transformation taking place right now, and it's up to you. It's up to all of us to resist it. The time is right now. Where is your line in the sand? Because the level of tyranny you will live under is the exact amount you will put up with.
Battle against COVID-19, drones could soon be monitoring your health from above, monitoring everything from social distancing to your heart rate. But what about your privacy? Eyewitness News reporter Dan Krauth gives us an exclusive look at technology now being put to use in a local community.
As communities look to try to safely reopen society, one local police department is using new technology to make that happen. And all you have to do is look up to find it. It's called a pandemic drone, and you'll find it hovering above popular places in Westport, Connecticut. As you can see outside this grocery store, it can measure whether people are social distancing. The circles determine if they're 6 feet apart. Green's good. Red's bad. They're using the technology now to make sure people are keeping their distance. The drones are also equipped with technology that can help determine everything from breathing to heart rate to coughing, even fever. It changes color. Canadian-based company behind the technology says it isn't designed to identify people. It's designed to identify patterns.
The system is designed to basically provide health monitoring data. And be able to make give us better data to make more clear decisions.
Decisions in the town of Westport that has experienced a spread of the virus in a county that has more than 40% of positive cases in the state. One of a handful of pandemic drones being launched across the country. They'll be testing out this new technology over the next 3 months before deciding whether or not to keep it.
This is absolutely frightening in a sense, but something that people need to fight back against. And this is right, again, out of the 1984 playbook, Big Brother. And this can only be done, of course, with the help of 5G technology. These drones, which are going to be flown, normally operated, and in some countries they're showing it as if they're operated by the military, holding, you know, little toy control panels, like they're 5 years old, flying around little airplanes in their backyard. 5G technology, like we've learned and heard even from lowlifes like Bill Nye, the science guy.
5G might one day give us driverless cars or drones that control their own drones or something.
That 5G technology would allow for these drones to fly independently on their own, without control, without somebody there literally doing it. They're following people around the streets in certain countries, now coming to America, now coming to Connecticut. Westport, Connecticut, testing the pandemic drone, which can monitor and detect people with infectious respiratory conditions in public areas amid the pandemic. The drone is said to, get a load of this, the drone is said to monitor people's temperatures from 190 feet away and has the ability to detect sneezing, coughing, and heart and breathing rates using sensors and computer vision. Just what we all need, right? They're telling us this is in our best interest. Oh, because if somebody sneezes, let's throw them in jail. Let's quarantine them for sneezing, for coughing. Now, I can tell you what I would do, or what I would hope that people would do if they saw one of these things in the street.
Mama don't like tattletales.
Wearing sunglasses.
And who are you, little fella? Come to show them where I am. Not nice.
Unfortunately, you can't rely on people to do that. And oh, that probably will get you 50 years behind bars, even though what right has citizens given our government to allow them to do this? The drone is going to take away all your privacy, anything regarding privacy outside of your home, because we've already given them the privacy inside our homes with the Echo, with the television, with the laptop, with the cell phones. Constant recording, constant monitoring, constant watching. Yeah, it's there for security, all right? The government's security against you to watch what your behavior is.
Well, thank you, everybody, for coming out. We've really wanted to come together today and kind of just talk about what we've learned over the last couple months here at Accelerated, and really talk about what's happening in Kern County with our testing, what's happening in California with the testing, and kind of an ER physician entrepreneur perspective on what's going on, and kind of what we think the approach should be going forward. And Dr. Masihi and myself have been dealing with this, as you have. I'm sure you guys are working from home, you're sheltering in place, you're isolating yourself, and we want to talk about if that still makes sense. So we want to kind of take everything we've learned and throw it against the backdrop of who we are. You know, we both have had extensive classes in microbiology and biochemistry and immunology. We've studied this for each of us 20 years, and we take everything that we're seeing today and we put that against that backdrop and say, does this make sense? Are we following the science? We decided to keep people at home and isolate them. These are good ideas when you don't have any facts. The hospitals, their ICUs are empty, essentially, and they're shutting down floors. They're furloughing patients, they're furloughing doctors. So the health system has been evacuated in certain places, getting rid of our doctors and nurses because we just don't have the volume. The hospitals don't, as I've met with their CEOs twice in the last week, and we don't as well. And so one of the things I'd like to talk about is when I talk to ER physicians around the country, what's happening? Well, because COVID has become the focus, people with heart disease, people with cancer, hypertension, and various things that are critical are choosing not to come in based on fear because we don't have the staff there. And the major component is fear. People are saying, I don't want to go get seen by my doctor. What if I get the COVID? Even though everything we've studied about quarantine, typically you quarantine the sick. When someone has measles, you quarantine them. We've never seen where we quarantine the healthy, where you take those without disease and without symptoms and lock them in your home. We don't know what's going on. We see this new virus. How should we respond? So we did that initially. And over the last couple months, we've gained a lot of data. So if we look at California, these numbers are from yesterday. We have 33,865 COVID cases out of a total of 280,900 total tested. That's 12% of Californians were positive for COVID. 12% positives. Well, if we have 39.5 million people. If we just take a basic calculation and extrapolate that out, that equates to about 4.7 million cases throughout the state of California, which means this thing is widespread. That's the good news. We've seen 1,227 deaths in the state of California with a possible incidence or prevalence of 4.7 million. That means you have a 0.03 chance of dying from COVID-19 in the state of California. 0.03 chance of dying from COVID in the state of California. Does that necessitate sheltering in place? Does that necessitate shutting down medical systems? Does that necessitate people being out of work? I also wanted to mention that 96% of people in California who get COVID recover with almost no significant sequelae or no significant continuing medical problems. We're sharing our own data. This isn't data filtered through someone. This is our own data. We found 6.5%, and then California has found 12%. So the more you test, the more positives you get, the prevalence number goes up and the death rate stays the same. So it gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And as we move through this data, what I want you to see is millions of cases, small amount of death. Millions of cases, small amount of death. And you will see that in every state. And since we're talking about following the science, we're going to follow the statistics and follow the science. So I want to look at New York State. So in New York, the ones they tested, they found 39% positive. So if that's indicative, and they tested 649,000 people, that's a massive test. That's accurate data, 39%. So if they tested the whole state, would we indeed have 7.5 million cases? We don't know. We will never test the entire state. So we extrapolate out. We use the data we have because it's the most accurate we have versus a predictive model that have been nowhere in the ballpark of accurate. So they, how many deaths do they have? 19,410 out of 19 million people, which is a 0.1% chance of dying from COVID in the state of New York. And they have a 92% recovery rate. If you are indeed diagnosed with COVID-19, 92% of you will recover. So we're seeing millions of cases, small amount of death. Millions of cases, small amount of death. And the reason I'm making that point is because we're going to compare this to flu and say, is this significantly different from influenza A and B? And if not, why has our response been what it is? USA, this is a big one for us. 802,590 cases as of yesterday. We've tested over 4 million. That's double what any other country. Germany's at 2. I realize their populations are lower, but the fact that we were able to ramp up and do 4 million is pretty impressive, which gives us a 19.6% positive out of those who are tested for COVID-19. 328 million people times 19.6 is 64 million. That's a significant amount of people with COVID. It's similar to the flu. If you study the numbers in 2017 and 2018, we had 50 to 60 million with the flu. And we had a similar death rate. In the deaths in the United States were 43,545. Similar to the flu of 2017, 2018. We always have between 37 and 60,000 deaths in the United States every single year. No pandemic talk, no shelter in place, no shutting down of businesses, no sending doctors home. And we don't necessarily report all of our flu tests. We do thousands of flu tests every year. We don't report every one because the flu is ubiquitous. And to that note, we have a flu vaccine. How many people even get the flu vaccine? The flu's dangerous. It kills people. So just because you have a vaccine doesn't mean it's going to be everywhere. And it doesn't mean everyone's going to take it, because we see every year that we have a vaccine and I would say probably 50% of the public doesn't even want it. So just because you have a vaccine, unless you force it on the public, doesn't mean they're going to take it. I want to compare the U.S. to Spain, because Spain is number two in the race for the most cases, which is not a race we want to win. They had 204,178 cases in Spain, 930,000 total tests. So we did 4 million, they did 930,000. They had a 22% of all COVID tests were positive in Spain. 22% of those tested were positive in Spain. Spain has 47 million people. So that equates to about 10 million cases. If we extrapolate the data as we've been doing with every state, gives us about 10 million cases. How many died in Spain? 21,282 out of 47 million. You have a 0.05 chance of dying from COVID as a citizen of Spain, and a 90% chance of recovery from COVID without being on a vent, without being in a hospital. I wanted to compare the US to Spain because we have the most amount of cases globally. So I thought that was important. And then when you bring up a system of lockdown, you automatically have to compare it to a system of no lockdown, Sweden and Norway. I'm Norwegian. Norway has lockdown, Sweden does not have lockdown. What happened in those two countries? Are they vastly different? Did Sweden have a massive outbreak of cases? Did Norway have nothing? Let's look at the numbers. Sweden has 15,322 cases of COVID. They did 74,600 tests, which is 21%, similar to the other countries, 21% of all those tested came out positive for COVID. What's the population of Sweden? About 10.4 million. So if we extrapolate out the data, about 2 million cases of COVID in Sweden. They did a little bit of social distancing. They would wear masks and separate. They went to schools, stores were open. They were almost about their normal daily life with a little bit of social distancing. They had how many deaths? 1,765. California's had 1,200 and 20 with isolation. No isolation, 1,765. We have more people. What I'm getting at is millions of cases, very small death. Millions of cases, very small death. This is what we're seeing everywhere. Norway, its next door neighbor. This is where I come from. These are two Scandinavian nations. We can compare them as they are similar. Let's look at the data. Norway, 7,191 cases of COVID. Total COVID tests, 145,279. So they came up with 4.9% of all COVID tests were positive in Norway. Population of Norway, 5.4 million. So if we extrapolate the data as we've been doing, which is the best we can do at this point, they have about 1.3 million cases. Now their deaths as a total number were 182, fairly small, but statistically insignificant from 1,700, you realize. Millions of cases, small amount of deaths. 1,700, 100, these are statistically insignificant. So you have a 0.003 chance of death as a citizen of Norway and a 97% recovery. Their numbers are a little bit better. Does it necessitate shutdown, loss of jobs, destruction of the oil company, furloughing doctors? That's the question I have for you. And I think the answer is going to be increasingly clear as we move through this data. What has it caused to have us be involved in social isolation? What has it caused that we are seeing the community respond to? Child molestation is increasing at a severe rate. We could go over multiple cases of children who have been molested due to angry family members who are intoxicated, who are home, who have no paycheck. These things last a lifetime. This isn't about a seasonal flu. These are things that will follow these people and affect them in a negative fashion for their life. And these are secondary effects from COVID. And these are for me talking to ERs, talking to my doctors, and talking to people across the country and finding out what they're seeing. Spousal abuse. We see people coming in here with black eyes and cuts on their face. It's an obvious abuse case. These are things that will affect them for a lifetime, not for a season. Alcoholism, anxiety, depression, suicide. Suicide is spiking. Education has dropped off. Economic collapse. Medical industry, we're all suffering because our staff isn't here and we have no volume. These are all real things that I'm seeing every day. I don't read about this stuff. I'm seeing it in my clinics. We have clinics from Fresno to San Diego, and these things are spiking in our community. These things will affect people for a lifetime, not for a season. So let's make sure we're clear on that. So we've gone over the secondary effects. We've gone over the statistics. Now I want to compare flu virus. Is this significantly different? And I just got a little bit of data here. So deaths per the CDC, 24,000 to 62,000 deaths each year. We had about 45 million total cases in 2017 with about 62,000 deaths, or a 0.13 chance of death from flu in the United States. As you know, our other numbers were 0.02. So the lethality of COVID-19 is much less. Now you've got hotbeds of it in New York, but again, we went over the numbers, 0.1% chance of death. Widespread, small amount of deaths. It's similar to flu, as a matter of fact. If we follow the science, as we've been asked to do, I'm following the science. This data is generated by the CDC, World Health Organization. The testing is generated by what we have done here. So we are following the science. Now I want to talk about the immune system. Dr. Masihi used to teach for immunology. We both had years of microbiology, biochemistry, and virology studies. We've made it our life's work to understand this stuff. And here, I'd like to go over some basic things about how the immune system functions so people have a good understanding. The immune system is built by exposure to antigens, viruses, bacteria. When you're a little child crawling on the ground, putting stuff in your mouth, viruses and bacteria come in, you form an antigen-antibody complex, you form IgG, IgM. This is how your immune system is built. You don't take a small child, put them in bubble wrap in a room and say, go have a healthy immune system. This is immunology, microbiology 101. This is not something, this is the basis of what we've known for years. When you take human beings and you say, go into your house, clean all your counters, Lysol them down, you're gonna kill 99% of viruses and bacteria. Wear a mask, don't go outside. What does that do to our immune system? Our immune system is used to touching. We share bacteria, staphylococcal, streptococcal bacteria, viruses. We develop an immune response daily to this stuff. When you take that away from me, my immune system drops. As I shelter in place, my immune system drops. You keep me there for months, it drops more. And now I'm at home, hand washing vigorously, washing the counters, worried about things that are indeed what I need to survive. Let's follow the science. This is immunology, folks. This is microbiology. This is what we've combined together. We have 40 years of experience in this. This is common sense immunology.
You think people are worrying too much?
Of course they are, but that's from media telling them to. I am telling them sheltering in place decreases your immune system. And then as we all come out of shelter in place with a lower immune system and start trading viruses and bacteria, what do you think is going to happen? Disease is going to spike. And then you've got disease spike amongst a hospital system with furloughed doctors and nurses. This is not the combination we want to set up for a healthy society. So it doesn't make any sense.
So is Dr. Fauci wrong then when he says that COVID-19 is shown to be nearly 10 times deadlier than the flu?
Initially, maybe that was true. But again, I'm going through the numbers. I'm not saying who's wrong or right. I'm going through the science and through the numbers.
I just want to be clear in terms of the definition of people dying of COVID. So the case definition is very simplistic. It means at the time of death, it was a COVID positive diagnosis. So that means that if you were in hospice and had already been given, you know, a few weeks to live, and then you also were found to have COVID, that would be counted as a COVID death. It means that if technically, if even if you died of a clear alternate cause, but you had COVID at the same time, it's still listed as a COVID death. So everyone who's listed as a COVID death doesn't mean that that was the cause of the death, but they had COVID at the time of death.
Are the reported deaths from COVID-19 truly deaths from COVID-19? To address this question, we need to discuss death certificates, since death certificates are the basic source of information about mortality. Still, we need to talk about it because they are the basis of the so-called death rate of COVID-19. History-changing decisions are being made due to these figures, despite the fact that they are flat-out wrong, based on data that is insufficient and often inaccurate. Few people know how much individual power and leeway is given to the physician, coroner, or medical examiner signing the death certificate. How do I know this? I've been filling out death certificates for over 30 years. More often than we want to admit, we don't know with certainty the cause of death when we fill out death certificates. That is just life. We are doctors, not God. Autopsies are rarely performed, and even when an autopsy is done, the actual cause of death is not always clear. Physicians make their best guesstimate and fill out the form. Then that listed cause of death, whatever we list, is entered into a vital records data bank to use for statistical analysis, which then gives out inaccurate numbers. Those inaccurate numbers then become accepted as factual information, even though much of it is false. So, even before we heard of COVID-19, death certificates were based on assumptions and educated guesses that go unquestioned. When it comes to COVID-19, there is the additional data skewer that is, get this, there is no universal definition of COVID-19 death. The Center for Disease Control updated from yesterday, April 4th, still states that mortality, quote unquote, data includes both confirmed and presumptive positive cases of COVID-19. That's from their website. Translation, the CDC counts both true COVID-19 cases and speculative guesses of COVID-19, the same. They call it death by COVID-19. They automatically overestimate the real death numbers by their own admission.
people should not be walking around with masks. You're sure of it? Because people are listening really closely to this.
Right now, people should not be walking. There's no reason to be walking around with a mask. When you're in the middle of an outbreak, wearing a mask might make people feel a little bit better, and it might even block a droplet, but it's not providing the perfect protection that people think that it is. And often, there are unintended consequences. People keep fiddling with the mask and they keep touching their face.
And can you get some schmutz sort of sting inside there?
Of course, of course. But when you think masks, you should think of healthcare providers needing them and people wearing them.
Virus was released. A secret file was uploaded to my data stream. It was a recording of a meeting of the Umbrella High Command, dated 17 months before the viral outbreak occurred.
We're here today not just to talk about the future of this company. We're here to talk about its destiny. We're here to talk about the end of the world. We stand on the brink of Armageddon, diseases for which we have no cure. Fundamentalist states who call for our destruction, nuclear powers over which we have no control. And even if we navigate these dangerous waters, we face other, even more inevitable threats. Unchecked population growth will overtake food production in less than 50 years, leading to famine and war. This is not conjecture. This is a fact. One way or another, our world is coming to an end. Now the question is, we end with it.
What do you propose?
I propose that we end the world, but on our terms. An orchestrated apocalypse. One that will cleanse the earth of its population but leave its infrastructure and resources intact. It's been done once before with great success. The chosen few will ride out the storm. Not in an ark, as in the book of Genesis, but in safety, underground. And when it's over, we will emerge onto a cleansed earth, one that we can then reboot in our image.
And just how do you intend to achieve this?
The means of our salvation are already at hand. I give to you the T-Virus.